Hello and welcome to this presentation of the Indiana University School of Medicine, Department of Radiology and Imaging Sciences. We'll be talking today about MRI safety for residents, specifically how to stop worrying and behave naturally when surrounded by magnets. The fact that you're here means that you're at least a little bit interested in the idea of MRI safety, and all joking aside, it is something very important that all residents and radiologists need to be aware of. The picture in front of you is obviously an extreme example of what can happen when people don't take safety in the MRI suite and the MRI machine seriously enough. But beyond dramatic examples like this, there can be smaller consequences, such as people entering the MRI suite with unsafe objects on their persons, which can lead to dangerous situations for patients, observers, and staff, as well as possible damage to machines and hospital property. In addition, there are specific reasons why residents might be particularly interested in the idea of MRI safety. There have been recent changes from the ACGME and from the American Board of Radiology in terms of how residency programs are expected to evaluate their residents. This comes in the form of the Milestones Project, which is a way of attempting to codify and structure resident evaluation. One of these specific areas of evaluation is that of patient safety as it relates to MRI safety within the MRI suite, MRI screening for patients and staff, as well as MR contrast issues. In addition, the new core diagnostic radiology exam from the American Board of Radiology at the end of third year of residency has its own emphasis on both MR safety and MR contrast issues that are of particular interest to all residents. For this presentation, we're going to focus on areas of interest to residents for daily workflow as well as for preparation for the core examination. We'll discuss what is affected by MRI machines. We're also going to talk about how to deal with implants as they arise with questions on a day-to-day basis. We'll talk about specific complications that can occur in the MR suite, a little bit on MR unit command and control and organization, and we'll end with a short discussion of MRI in pregnancy. The MRI effect is actually pretty simple. It boils down to metal, heavy or otherwise, whatever form you want it to take. Metallic objects on the whole are affected by magnetic fields, and they come in a variety of different flavors. Ferromagnetic applies to objects that contain iron. Paramagnetic is an object that is affected by a magnetic field but does not significantly contain iron. And then diamagnetic materials are materials that are actually not particularly affected by an MRI field. If you put an object that is affected by magnets within a magnetic field, you can get both translational and rotational motion. Specifically, motion within a line is translational, and rotational motion is around an axis of the object itself. Things along the lines of brass, aluminum, and plastic are okay for a magnetic field in an MRI suite, and a variety of MR-safe objects containing materials such as these are used for daily medical action. There are specific metal detectors that can detect specific ferromagnetic objects. However, most metallic detectors cannot differentiate between things that are and are not safe with an MR suite. So in order to care for our patients and our machines and ourselves, all metallic objects must be treated as if they're potentially dangerous in an MR suite. Listed below are some ferromagnetic objects that can be potentially encountered in an MRI suite on a day-to-day basis. Very specific and basic things along the lines of pens and pencils, keys, mops, metallic gas cylinders, things that we use for oxygen. A wide variety of common objects are unsafe in the MR suite and need to be avoided on a day-to-day basis. Practically speaking, as residents, entering the MR unit is not something that we're going to do on a day-to-day basis. However, beyond knowing the types of objects that should not be brought into an MR suite for the times that we do enter them, we deal with the MR effect and things about magnetic safety usually as it applies to implants, things that patients have on them, and questions about whether or not MR can be performed safely on these patients. This is a relatively common concern for both residents and practicing radiologists. We'll get questions from clinicians and technologists about whether a specific exam can be performed on this patient who has, say, an aneurysm clip from previous coiling or a pacemaker or some sort of other implanted device. The American College of Radiology mandates best effort assessments for devices. That's specifically from their paper on setting up your MR suite and maintaining and caring for your patients in a safe manner. And best effort is in quotation marks because it's specifically drawn from this paper, meaning that as the radiologist in charge of the MRI suite, you're expected to do whatever's in your power to attempt to answer the question about safety with an implant to the best of your ability. an extremely useful tool for attempting to answer these questions about the safety of implanted devices in the MR suite is MRISafety.com, which contains the list. The aptly, if uncreatively named, list is an up-to-date collection of medical devices and whether or not these devices are safe for the MR suite. It's searchable by device type, manufacturer, and is relatively versatile in terms of finding the device that you're interested in. There's a wide variety of specific brands and models of both common and uncommon medical devices, and for each device, there is a recommendation in terms of whether the object is definitely MR safe, definitely MR unsafe, or conditional, meaning that it can be MR safe if a variety of factors are met, such as how long the device has been implanted or what type of magnet you're using, be it a 1.5, a 3T, etc. If for whatever reason you're unable to find the answer using MRISafety.com in the list, you have other options. Your MRI technologists can be a useful source of information in terms of devices they've seen used before. In addition, there are published books or other compendiums of MR-safe devices that oftentimes are available within the MR suites of our institutions. And if all else fails and you know the type of device, visiting the manufacturer's website can actually be quite useful, as they often publish information about whether or not their devices have been proven MR-safe. As a brief primer, we can talk shortly about some of the common devices that were asked about. Most pacemakers to date are not MR safe. Some of the newer versions have been proven to be MR safe, but for the most part, these are a no-go for MRI. Most of our aneurysm clips, they're kind of hit or miss. It sort of depends on the manufacturer and the type of clip in terms of whether or not it's safe for the MR unit. Heart valves, coils, and stents, however, are usually MR safe. But again, you'll always want to check the specifics in terms of the type of device that your patient has. Beyond implants, residents are expected to assist with patient assessment in terms of whether or not they have any metallic or other MR unsafe objects in or on their bodies. Most commonly, this is performed outside of the resident's normal workflow with patient questionnaires. These are usually done by patients or families and require on their recall, which, as we all know, can be imperfect. Sometimes we're asked to assist by reviewing old images, usually radiographs or CT images, to look for metal. We can also ask about specific metal exposures. This often comes in a form of occupational exposure to metal shavings or eye trauma, which can leave metallic objects in unsafe locations. This is an example of an MR screening sheet used by our institution. Again, its job is to screen for any common metallic objects that may be in the patient's body or on the patient's body in an attempt to decide if the patient is safe for MRI. Beyond metallic implants, there are other concerns with metal in the MR suite. Any looped electronics can cause induced electric currents when exposed to a magnetic field, and patients oftentimes come with conductors on them, specifically looped wires, EKG leads, or even if the patient has crossed limbs within an MR suite, this can be enough to induce an electric current, which can lead to burns or other superficial trauma. Objects external to the patient can also cause issues with overheating, specifically things along the lines of tattoos or surgical staples, which can have relatively small amounts of metal, can overheat and cause superficial burns or at least a sensation of heat on the patient's skin. Usually, we simply warn patients in advance that this could be a problem during the scan and use cold compresses as needed for patient's symptoms. Another unique challenge when it comes to patient safety in the MR suite is that of medication patches on the skin. These oftentimes contain small amounts of metal, and the MR suite can induce burn or heating, or even can change the amount of dose delivered by these patches. These patches have their own specific section under the MRISafety.com list. They're called Conditional 3. And although they can be safe in an MR suite, we usually remove them simply because of the possibility of dose change and superficial effects. At this point, we're going to change gears and discuss how the MR suite is organized as mandated by the American College of Radiology. This is also a specific section of interest to the ABR core exam. Now, given the fact that MR units can be of a potential danger to the public, they are usually a controlled environment wherever they are found. They're divided into zones based off of increasing magnetic risk, and only certain personnel are to be allowed within certain areas the closer you get to the magnet. Zone 1 is the first area in an MRI facility. It is an area outside of the control of MR personnel and an area open to the general public. Hallways in the hospital and outside of the MR suite are a specific example, and there is no magnetic threat in this region to patients or employees. Next, we arrive in Zone 2, which is to be used as a patient and non-MR personnel reception area. This zone is controlled by the MRI technicians and other staff and contains no magnetic risk to patients. The job of Zone 2 is to act as a staging area for entry of patients and other personnel deeper into the MR suite. Moving deeper into the NR unit, we then arrive at Zone 3. This is a zone with no free access that is to be locked, with access restricted to MR personnel and chaperone patients. This is the first zone with the possibility of a magnetic threat. Each MR suite is a little bit different, but in every suite you'll reach a point called the 5 Gauss line, and this is the line at which the magnetic strength reaches 5 Gauss, which is considered to be the first area that you really need to start being careful in terms of metallic objects and other issues in terms of magnetic effect. This line varies depending on the type and strength of magnet, and oftentimes is delineated by a line on the floor depending on the type of MR unit that you're in. The final unit within the MRI suite is Zone 4, and this is specifically where the magnet proper is. There's no free access, much like Zone 3, only trained MR technicians and controlled patients are to enter this area. This is the area with highest magnetic threat. Obviously, you're closest to the magnet, and the magnetic field strength is going to be higher. A short word about codes. If a patient has a code or some sort of other critical medical issue within Zone 4, the ACR guidelines recommend that the patient be removed from Zone 4 and taken to a designated area outside the 5 Gauss line before resuscitation should take place for patient safety and for medical personnel safety. We'll now briefly discuss pregnancy as it relates to the MRI suite. As residents and radiologists, this often comes down to obtaining informed consent from pregnant patients prior to having an MRI done. Usually this discussion boils down to describing to the patient the procedure and then discussing that through years and years of experience, there has been very little evidence to suggest that there's any harm to mother or fetus during an MRI scan during pregnancy. However, consent is obtained because our knowledge is pretty limited scientifically, as it's difficult to do randomized controlled or otherwise strong studies on pregnant patients. As discussed previously, there is relatively limited data in terms of randomized controlled or other trials on pregnancy and MRI. Those that have been done listed below have shown very specific information regarding no increase or decrease or disability on mothers or babies on follow-up after having an MRI done. There's been shown to be no restriction in fetal growth, no effect on pregnant MR workers around the magnets, and no evidence of hearing loss within the fetus after having an MRI performed. These human trials are relatively small in terms of the number of patients enrolled. There have been some lab and animal trials that have shown no harm, but there are a few animal studies that do suggest some harm also in the area of hearing loss. However, again, these are small animal-based, and it's difficult to say whether there's any correlation to human studies. As such, when we discuss with our pregnant patients, we usually tell them that our own experience has shown no effect on mother or fetus over a large variety and large number of studies. We simply obtain consent due to the limited scientific information. The last area of interest in MRI in pregnancy is with the use of gadolinium-based intravenous contrast materials. Gadolinium has been shown to cross the placenta following administration of contrast material. However, the effects are not particularly well studied or understood. As such, gadolinium is not routinely used in pregnant patients. As we close this discussion, we'll review what we've talked about so far. When we deal with MRI safety in terms of objects that can be affected by a magnetic field, metal is the key. There are far more objects that you or I may think of in our day-to-day practice that may be affected by the magnet. Common things that both patients, care providers, and other staff have on them at all times that need to be screened for patients and staff entering deep into the MR suite. The patient may also have other reasons to be affected by the MR magnet. We discussed a few of them before, such as looped wires or crossed limbs, or tattoos or surgical staples leading to heating or induced electrical currents. In addition, medication patches are something else that needs to be looked out for. When dealing with implant checks, a common problem for radiologists and residents, we need to know where to go in order to maintain the best efforts mandated by the American College of Radiology. We discussed MRISafety.com and the use of the list, as well as discussing with your in-house technologists or colleagues information about whether or not patient devices are MR safe. It's also important to understand how the MRI unit needs to be a controlled environment, specifically how it's split into the specific zones. We discussed zones 1 through 4 and how they become increasingly more stringent in terms of what type of person can enter those areas and how much the magnetic effect increases as you move through the zones. It's important to understand that code situations need to be carried out outside of the 5 Gauss line in a designated area for both patient and personnel safety. And we discussed that all of our limited data suggests that MR is pregnancy safe and that consent is obtained for pregnant patients due to our lack of complete scientific knowledge. We also discussed that gadolinium should not be used in pregnant patients as it can cross the placenta and its effects are incompletely understood. This concludes our discussion on MRI safety for residents as it pertains to daily workflow, the ACGME and ABR Milestones Project, and the ABR Core Exam. On behalf of the Indiana University Department of Radiology and Imaging Services, I'd like to thank you for listening to our discussion, and I hope that you found it informative and useful.